It's the night.
The game is a question of scruples.
Just play something that he considered to be very nice, and you just couldn't hear a thing. I mean, it was Ladies and Gentlemen, the beat.
That's it.
That was it. And it just went on like that until they finished.
Meeting the Queen, Her Majesty, great lady. Like her very much. Very knowledgeable. She's surprising. You know, you think, well, being Queen's a hard job. I mean, how's she going to know about Beatle music? But when you think about it, like Elizabeth, I mean, it's a little bit flash, this, but I think it's true in a way. Elizabeth I had sort of Sir Walter Raleigh during her reign. Elizabeth II's had the Beatles. I mean, I'm not comparing us, but it's true. This is what we're one of the events that have happened during her reign. So she's quite hip to it all. It was always going to be like that, though. You know, when the Beatles split up, I think all four of us realized it was a case of follow that. And at first, I did find it very difficult and did do a lot of justifying. I don't bother so much now. You don't like me? Tough. Because, you know, you grow up and you suddenly think, I can't handle all this. You know, I like me. And, you know, I'm not going to sort of, you know, go crazy trying to get everyone to, please, you know, accept me. I'm all right. You know, it's terrible to go around like that. Nobody has to go around like that. Most people, you know, they just say, don't like it. Don't buy it, or whatever, you know. So I'm getting a lot better on all of that now. I figure I've done a bit anyway, even since the Beatles. You know, I've done things now.
Cover Story, sponsored by April Fresh Downy, the fabric softener that gives your wash skin-loving downy softness and airy April freshness your whole family loves.
It's great. It's very interesting being married. It's a strange thing. Two people, you know, opposite sexes, in our case, you know, suddenly, like, living and sleeping with each other, and it's a weird, weird thing. I think it's great. It's a very special experience, I think.
I met Paul at a club. We had both gone down with different people. I had been photographing the animals, who were all friends of mine. So we were at a great table right next to the group. And then Paul walked in with some people, and our eyes met.
We've married 17 years, you know, that's something to actually like each other at the end of that. But it's not always swinging. You know, I think that's what I'm talking about. That's the other interesting side of it. You're living with someone that you don't necessarily know. You don't always sort of know. You know, you're always learning. You're finding out about them, which is the fun. There's a lot of action. The kids, I've got four kids. It's a lot of action. But you see each little age group. You know, I've got a 23-year-old and I've got an 8-year-old and two in between. So you see the music they're into, and you see their excitement at going to a concert. It's no longer your own excitement at going to a concert, maybe. You just kind of see things through their eyes. And that's all new for me. So that bit of it I like, you know. I don't really live too rich. You know, you see these programs, Rich and Famous, and, you know, I've got money and stuff, and I enjoy it. But I don't really have the fleet of limos and millions of chauffeurs. And it's not like Dynasty at our house. I'd rather do it how we did it when I was a kid. I'll try and bring up my kids the same way as my dad brought me up.
We have the best kids. I think because we spend time with our kids. I think there's a big problem in the world right now, because I think a lot of people have had children and didn't realize it's not just you have a child and isn't it cute. You have to love that child and direct that child, you know, to give, to have relationships. A lot of people don't think of their kids as friends. My kids are my best friends. They really are. I can tell them anything, they can tell me anything. And I think it's important.
I think it's tough because you're dad, you've got the position of authority, which isn't easy.
I never thought I've married a Beatle. People say to me, you've married a Beatle, it still is like, oh yeah. When the Beatles split up, he really didn't want them to split up. He was blamed for it because that again was the press and they got it wrong. He wanted the Beatles to go on forever. And he felt very naked when they broke up.
I think I was feeling like I would, just the longer I waited with another day of no work, another day of nothing to go to, the more I was just getting stagnant. It's a bit like sort of after an operation where you want to rest, but you've got to push it. And I just had to push something.
She can't be found.
The only way I knew how to do it was just get back on the boards again with anything. So I'd hit upon the idea of just getting, you know, a bunch of people around me who would play, and we could just go out, and it didn't matter if it was big time or small time or anything, it'd still be just playing.
She'll be here.
When I joined Wings, I should have said no. But Paul just said, hey, why don't we start a group? Here's middle C, you could play keyboard, here's middle C, learn the piano, and you can do a few harmonies, and we'll be together, and it'll be such fun. I went, oh, great, forgetting this is Paul McCartney, right? Thinking this, okay, I could join a little punk group or something. Anyway, so I tried rehearsing, I tried learning all these very hard bits. I didn't do that bad.
She was ridiculed. He was ridiculed for doing it. I mean,
it was an awful joke.
Well, it's like taking your wife to work, isn't it? Yeah. You know, and all the guys are saying, you know, what's going on?
There was an awful joke, because I think sometimes people tend to forget that Paul and people in show business are actually humans. I think they forget it sometimes. There was a dreadful joke going around about name a dog with wings, Linda McCartney, you know. And I think people really do forget they're talking about human beings when they put some of these things they put in reviews, or, you know, why shouldn't the guy have his missus there? It might be great psychological support for him. He might really need it. They should be grateful that he's out on the road and happy that whatever it takes to get him on stage is there.
So, you know, Linda was there on keyboards, terrified out of her mind all the time. That's about the craziest thing you can do, bring in your wife who's not had any previous musical experience. Well, you know, people couldn't accept that just we wanted to go back to square one and just become a little skiffle group again. And we were back at that stage, but it was the only thing I could think of to do, you know, and I thought I was doing just what I knew how to do.
Wings always did a thing to my mind. Wings was always entertaining. I never, ever, ever heard anything from Wings that wasn't good or wasn't something creative or entertaining, you know? Wings was a group that just didn't know how to stop with the creativity. They just didn't know how to stop, so they kept going. You know what I mean? They just kept going and going. Somebody ringing the bell. Someone knocking at the door. Somebody ringing the bell. Well, do me a favor. Open the door.
There's always that little moment before an opening night or something, oh, what am I in this business for? Why aren't I a gardener? It's a much more peaceful life. Pay's not as good, but you know, the rewards are just, you know. You go through all of that, then you get up there and it's incredible and you think, this is why I'm not a gardener. I like this plonking around too much.
A lot's changed since I was in high school, especially here at the San Diego Hall of Champions Sports Museum. Today, there are over 40 sports represented and lots of exciting exhibits. So check it out and share in San Diego sports heritage. Who knows? It could be the thrill of a lifetime.
Paul's film, Give My Regards to Broad Street, surprised people more than anything else because it was a serious story about the music world presented as a fantasy. Once again, Paul McCartney expressed himself in his own terms rather than according to the expectations of the world.
The whole thing started for me out of wanting to do a film. wanted to actually just be involved in the process of making a film.
It was a gentle English film, you know, sort of slightly wacky, offbeat sort of thing, really. But like I say, you know, what are you going to do? There's no violence, no sex. How's it going to be a hit?
I really do like creating a song or helping create a set or a costume or a story. And fantasy really interests me a lot.
I think there's some good things in it, you know. I'm slightly disappointed, obviously, that it didn't just kind of do great. I think it's not a bad flick, actually, you know, looking back on it. I think that Broad Street, maybe it's in the long term, it'll settle down.
But I thought it was good, and I got a feeling it'll be one of them things that I'll see in a couple of years and really enjoy.
Dad, hey, Dad, when's the show going to start? Hey, Dad.
Now, look, son, this only happens once every couple of hundred years. If you don't pipe down, I will not bring you again. Shut up.
Paul's next film effort, the animated featurette Rupert and the Frog Song, which he co-wrote and produced with his wife Linda, has become a hit all over the world. McCartney grew up with the Rupert the Bear stories and introduced Linda to England's beloved cartoon character. And the rest, as they say, is history.
He's a very big star in England, Rupert, anyway. He's
Mickey Mouse.
Yeah, he's Mickey Mouse.
Yeah.
He's our Mickey Mouse, yeah.
They rang me up, and this time they said, we've got a band. You don't have to just play your piano, you can bring your guitar this time. And it was like a colossal band. It's all the best British musicians, well, most of them anyway, you know, fabulous band to play in front of. Singing with someone like Tina's great. I've never sung with her before, and she's just such an up. And someone like me who admires her anyway, you know, I love sort of R&B. I love my R&B, you know, so just to actually be allowed to be on the same stage will do me. So that rekindled my interest in the live thing.
It's just what he wants to write, and he gets away with it. I mean, I think he, you know, he does a lot of things tongue in cheek as well. Like he writes things like "Mary Had a Little Lamb" after yesterday, he's going to be a bit cheeky.
Well, there used to be a saying. I don't know if it was around over here, but over in England, there used to be a saying that someone was so big that they could record "Mary Had a Little Lamb," and he did.
Yeah, just tried it out.
Got to own up. Yeah, that's how big he is. Yep.
Because the minute you take risks. Somebody says, oh, I like your old stuff, when you know, McCartney ballads. So I wanted to sort of get away from that and just do something simpler. So the idea became, let's just go down the subway.
Darling, I love you very, very, very much. And I really am relying on your touch. But with all these people listening in,
it was a bit risky because, you know, there was like no budget to shore it all up. It's that you know, what you see is what you get there, you know. So the people on the tube had to deliver.
I know it really wouldn't be a crime. I say I want to love you all the time. But with all these people listening in, I don't know.
I've always tried to just do my own stuff to keep me interested, for one thing. I'm much easier on myself these days about all that stuff. Occasionally I'll be overcritical, but generally I sort of think life's not long enough, you know. Four kids and stuff, you know, I don't need the problems, don't need the aggro.
You know it as a powder. You love it as a spot fighter.
Cascade. Beautiful.
Now there's a new way to get virtually spotless.